Hello. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on your respective time zone. And welcome to my part two of history of space exploration through Matchbox's presentation. In part one, that was the history of aviation through Matchbox's, which happened last Saturday, we saw how man learned to fly, and all those events, all those involved personalities, and all those we saw through matchboxes. But man wasn't satisfied with flying on the earth. So man always had urge to fly beyond earth also. And I would say that's why eventually man took a leap into the space. And that's where the second presentation, today's presentation, that's what the today's presentation covers. So today we will see a history of space flight through matchboxes. Before we begin, let me introduce myself. I am Kaustubh Shezwalkar. I learned engineering. I studied engineering and worked in software industry and retired recently. And collecting matchboxes, as you must have been must have guessed, is my hobby. And I think let's start my presentation. I will explain what does these matchboxes mean and what all they show. So most of us are familiar with matchboxes, and in addition to matchboxes, there are other things also related to matchboxes, and I collect all of them. Most of us have seen the matchbox, but I also collect matchbox labels, the label that is put on those boxes, and matchbooks. It is a different kind of matchbox. So I have about 13,000 plus matchboxes in my collection, and usually other collectors who collect matchboxes, they classify their collection based on either animals, birds, maybe fruits, flowers, numbers, vehicles, advertisement. But I decided to take a different path, and that's why I classified my collection into these themes. One is calendar through matchboxes, history through matchboxes, space exploration through matchboxes, history of matchboxes, and fun on matchboxes. So today is the part two where we will see how man took a leap into the space. And let me tell you at the outset, I won't be telling you anything new. We all know about the history of space flight. Only thing is, many of us are not aware that there are so many matchboxes or matchbooks, matchbox labels, which relate to all those events, all those astronomers, all those phenomena, scientific phenomena, astronomical phenomena. So let's begin our journey. The early man must have obviously noticed the sun and moon. The rising of sun, setting of sun, and then rising of moon, setting of moon, and so many stars shining in the night. And over a period of time, the man noticed that there is some pattern or there is some regularity in their rotation. And initially, as a part of astronomy, and eventually as a part of astrology in Western astrology, this entire space around us, whatever we can see in the sky, was divided into 30-degree sectors. And whatever constellation passes through a particular area, depending on the sign that we can observe over there in the sky, all those were named. And here is the entire set of matchboxes, which shows the zodiac signs. In addition to these stars and zodiacs and constellations, over a period of time, different astronomers, amateurs, and plain observers, They noticed many planets. They discovered planets of our solar system. So this is a set, Dutch set, which shows the planets of our solar system. In addition to these astronomical phenomena, obviously, as the sun rises, it gets brighter. We have light everywhere, and when the sun sets, we have dark, and it is a night. So the man observed that there is a pattern of light and darkness, and these matchbooks and labels, they show us the day and night at the same location. The Seven Falls matchbook that shows by day how the waterfall can be seen, and the next one besides it, adjacent to it, shows how the waterfall looks at the night. Then we have the Jersey castle, how it looks during the day and how it is seen at the night. So the man observed that we have a pattern of day and night, and eventually to count the time, these day and night were clubbed together as a day. But day was a very short unit of time. So we bunch all those days together, 7 days together, and man started counting all those that bunch as a week. So that became a kind of more useful or practical unit, how many weeks to measure the time. And here is a set of matchbooks from Monday to Sunday. In addition to days, day and night and all those, because Earth axis is tilted, different areas receive different amount of sunlight during the rotation. So based on that, different seasons actually happen. And here are these matchbooks which show different seasons. And depending on how much sunlight that particular area receives, the nature responds or reacts to it. And we have spring, then summer, autumn, winter. So all these seasons also were observed by that early man. In addition to all these, there was a rhythmic rise and fall of sea level for the coastal people. And eventually man discovered that this happens because of the gravitational pull of the nearest astronomical bodies like sun, moon. So these two matchbooks, they actually are of Hilton Hawaii Village Hotel, and they show the same location at different tide levels. So the first one is at high tide, and the next one is at low tide or ebb. So the tides also were noticed, and then once in a while during the night, people used to see some shooting stars. So there are some rocky or metallic bodies in the outer space, and when they enter Earth's atmosphere due to gravitational pull of Earth, due to the friction, they start burning, and we see them like a shooting stars. So people observed, man observed these meteors. Obviously, then over a period of time, man also observed that there is something like in the broad daylight, some shadow obscures the sun, or during middle of the or during night, the moon is again shadowed by some body. So these kind of eclipses also were observed. And we have these matchbooks. Obviously, the first one actually doesn't show exactly the location or the position of astronomical bodies to depict the eclipse. But this is the closest thing I have or in my matchbook. But the next one is an Italian hotel, and that matchbook actually shows the eclipse. So once in a while, eclipse was observed. Then over a longer period of time, comets were observed. Now these comets, there are some comets which regularly visit our solar system and some just visit once and then they simply never come back. So these also were observed, those were noted. And one of these is the very famous one is Halley's Comet. And last time Halley's Comet visited our solar system was in 1986. And now next he will be visiting in 2061. And this matchbook, the front side shows the Halley's Comet name and the back side shows gives the description about it. So this is really before 1986. Well, all these observations and all these what we can say measurements were made by various people, and now we will see some of those. Nicholas Copernicus was the Polish mathematician, astronomer, and he was the first person to propose that Earth and all other planets rotate around the Sun. And until then, people used to think that Earth is at the center of the world or universe, and everything revolves around Earth. But he was the first person to propose that Earth and other planets, they revolve around the Sun. And he is considered as father of modern astronomy. And here are some matchbox labels which shows some notes by Copernicus, his model. Then we have Galileo. He made contribution in many fields. He made the first telescope and made some observation, noted them. He's called as father of observational astronomy. Then we have a giant figure, Sir Isaac Newton. He was a multi-talented person. He contributed in mathematics, physics, astronomy, and other fields also. Then we have Albert Einstein. He contributed in physics, theoretical physics, and space time. He is famous for his mass energy equivalence formula E is equal to mc square, but his contribution in space research also is notable. So all these observations, earlier people used to do using whatever things they had with them to measure or to observe astronomical different events. So the first label depicts the Stonehenge in England. The next one besides it, it shows the head stones on Easter Island. So all these are constructed to measure distances between stars, or some they the stones are aligned in such a way that on particular day the sunlight fall on particular at particular point. So all these are kind of ancient observatories. And as the science progressed, we now have modern observatories which have the telescope, advanced telescopes, and other technical equipments to observe things and take measurements. So here are matchboxes about the Palmer Observatory and Australian National University's telescope. As the science progressed, astronomy progressed, eventually Russia launched the first artificial satellite in 1957, 4th October 1957. And that actually shocked and shook, I mean, that actually shocked the world and shook America, because they were the Cold War giants and there was a kind of space race between them. So with launching Sputnik in the orbit, Russia made the first move, we can say. And on 4th October, the Sputnik 1 was launched. And subsequently, within next few weeks, on 3rd November 57, Russia again sent a dog, Laika, in the space. So Laika is the first dog who went up in the space, orbited Earth. After that, Russia again gained some, we can say, head start. And on 12th April 1961, Yuri Gagarin became the first person, first human to go into the space and orbit the Earth. And as I mentioned earlier, because America was shocked and shook because of this Russia's advances, they started, I mean, here we are seeing the set of Yuri Gagarin matchboxes. So they show Yuri Gagarin's contribution and how he was trained, what all things he did. So all these are shown in this set. And because of that, whatever information gained from Yuri Gagarin, that actually helped Russia go still more, further. And Valentina Tereshkova was the first woman who went up in the space. So until all these stages, Russia was leading in astronomy, space science. And because of this, America actually launched this Apollo missions. Eisenhower actually launched this mission, and eventually they succeeded in the goal of this Apollo mission was to land a man on the moon. And America was trying to do this first. So they kind of give push to this, and there were quite a few Apollo missions, starting from one, and eventually through Apollo 11, Neil Armstrong became the first person to land on the moon. So on 28 July 1969, he landed on the moon, and that made history. So here are a few matchbooks from different countries. The first one is from Canada. Next one is from USA. It is that shows the newspaper declaring Neil Armstrong's achievement. Again, the next one shows that is from USA, that shows Neil Armstrong standing adjacent to the American flag on the moon. So all this was actually, we can say, rocket science. But although it is rocket science, there are quite a few jokes related to this rocket science, astronomy also. So these are the matchbooks. They actually talk about or they show some jokes related to space age. So this is what I have covered up to man's landing on moon. And beyond that also, there were quite a few achievements, and there are a few matchbooks. But I would like to stop here for now. And this is what I have covered, from the early man to how we landed on the moon. So now I am open for questions. So if anyone has any questions, you can ask them, and I will try to answer them to the best of my abilities. Anish Mehta had asked, these matchboxes are from which country? There are matchboxes from various countries. Mostly Russia used matchbox as a platform to kind of make propaganda about their achievement. So many of these are from Russia, but in addition to Russia, there are matchbooks or matchboxes from USA, then Canada, many of the European countries, then Australia, and even some Asian countries also have space or astronomy related matchboxes. So they are from many countries. Anish Mehta had asked again another question, were these matchboxes available to public, or was circulated to select groups only? It so happens that some of these matchboxes, even today, are kind of special edition. They are released to commemorate some event or some personality. So they are in limited edition kind of thing. But they are actually available for public also. Only thing is we are not aware. And if you know someone is releasing them, you get them, or maybe later on if you search them, and catalogs are published for Russian, especially for Russian matchboxes, catalogs are published. So if you have such catalog, you can search and try to get them. Dharmesh Thakkar has asked next question: are these kind of designs still popular on matchboxes? That is difficult to answer. We still get matchboxes, but the thing is now the matchboxes themselves are not that much in use. I mean, earlier they were actually used to lighting for lighting fire, but as we have lighters from 1970s, use of matchboxes reduced, but space or theme related matchboxes are still released. And I believe recently we celebrated the 50th year of moon landing, and some matchbooks are also released. I still don't have them in my collection, but yeah, these and many different kinds of design, because based on the country and their culture, different designs are popular. So we can't say that this particular design is popular, but we still get once in a while matchboxes, and these matchboxes are still released. Okay, next question is from Ravindra Nevadkar: is this a specifically designed collection or usual matchboxes? These are all usual standard matchboxes, and if you remember, the set I showed was the Yuri Gagarin set. That actually is released in a bigger box, and in that big box there were all small matchboxes. So each one of them you can pick it out and use as a matchbox. So they are actually released as a matchbox. So if you really want to use them, you can use them as a matchbox also. But I'm sure that none of the matchbox collectors will ever like to use them as a matchbox. But yeah, they are released as usual matchboxes. Okay, next question is from Anish Mehta again: has Indian made matchboxes covered this topic? I'm sorry to say, but there aren't many matchboxes related to astronomy or space or any of these events. But there are two different designs of inside matchbox. And so far I don't have them in my collection, but there are very few and far in between matchboxes which are released related to this topic. There are some matchboxes, but they are I would say very kind of general, like rocket, then stars. The earliest, the first one which I shared about sun and moon, those were from India. So we do have some matchboxes related to this theme, but not very technical ones. Parag Redkar has a next question: how to transport it by official means? I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. How to transport the matchboxes, you mean? Or if you are talking about matchboxes, then like any other thing, I get those matchboxes from either shops or from my friends or over internet, and just get them. And even they are also delivered through post also. especially the empty ones. Are there any more questions? If you, I mean, if you think of any question, you can still email that to me at kaustubh007@yahoo.com. I think Anish Mehta has another question. What is the oldest box in this collection? Oldest box. I haven't actually thought on those lines, but I think Copernicus label, I think, is the oldest one. That is probably based on the ink that is used, the printing, the fonts. Based on that, I think that is from 1940s or so. And all other obviously were released after all those events happened, like Yuri Gagarin, Valentina Tereshkova, Laika, Sputnik. So all those are relatively recent, but I believe that Copernicus one is the oldest one in my collection. I think there aren't any more questions. If you don't have any questions, then let's conclude it here. I would like to thank you all, guys, and thank the Hobby Club for providing me this platform. And I would appeal all of you to please subscribe our channel, and you will get to see such presentations of different hobbies by other members of our group. So, and if you still have any questions, you can email them anytime at kaustubh007@yahoo.com. Okay, thank you, guys. Bye. Have a good day.